Welcome to the last session for today. After this session, well, we have two talks in the session. After this session, there is a farewell greeting in the next room over there. So after the second talk, please all swiftly move over there, and then we have the conference closing. But now we have Raichu, who is going to name dance Spectre for us today.
Yeah. Enjoy. So yeah, hi everyone. I'm Raichu, so a little warning ahead. This is going to be the only slide. So the rest of this presentation will be me hacking away on the terminal and pretty much winging it because I decided to make some last minute changes to this talk. So might probably be a little bit surprising. So while I'm going to give a little bit of introduction, I want three of you to, later for a demo, I want three people here and you can decide if you want to come here and give a little Spectre demo. I want to explain how this security problem works, and it might be a little bit more interesting if we have people here. So, before we start, a quick show of hands. Who here is using D-Trix? Amazing, one person. That is pretty much the amount that I kind of expected in an audience like that, so I'm thrilled that so many people showed up here, because I'm the person who's bringing knife to a gunfight. This is talking about operating systems on functional programming conferences, probably not going to attract that many people. Hopefully I'm not going to disappoint you. So for those of you who do not know what D-Trace is, which is probably most of you, I want to fill you in on this stuff. What is it? So it's open source. It's been developed on Solaris. It's now been ported to basically all the major operating systems. So it's been ported to FreeBSD, to NetBSD, OS X, there's support for QNX. I heard there's support for Windows. It's kind of weird, but I don't know, never seen it. And there is also work to have it on systems like Linux, but they have their own thing. So most of you will probably know the classic statical tools that you use for analyzing your programs, which are, in most cases, it's S-Trace. Well, you use S-Trace to look at the system calls that a program is emitting, so you can figure out what's going on in there, because you only have so much information that you can get out of the process. We have a very similar tool on FreeBSD, which is called Truss, and these things are kind of nice, but it's actually pretty limited. You can just look at one process at a time, and with systems that we have right now, these are pretty complicated. Like, really complex stuff is going on there. We have databases, we have all these different layers, we have virtual file systems, networks, databases. All of these things are communicating with each other. And so we want to be able to look at the system as a whole. We want to correlate all the data and figure out what's going on inside of the system in case something is going wrong. Because when something is going wrong in a system with that much complexity, everyone is blaming the other one. So it's the DBA who's doing something wrong, or it's the software developers who are doing something wrong, or whatever. Choice of programming language is also like, you're using Haskell, of course, that doesn't work. And we call this the blame game. And with D-Trace, it's a little bit easier to figure out what's really going on the system. So it's a lot easier to do finger pointing here and actually solve the problem. So it's not about finger pointing, it's really pinpointing the problem. So yeah. So another thing that I want to emphasize is that you don't want to build software like debug versions of the software. You want to use the existing software that you're actually deploying in production. Because let's assume that something goes wrong in a production system, and you don't know what's going wrong. So you cannot just swap out all the processes for debug code. That is pretty much out of the picture. You have to modify, you have to look at the actual stuff that is running in production. And it's also very important if you take things like compiler optimizations into account. I will show you a little bit of timing attack stuff, and sometimes a timing attack can be introduced by a compiler optimization. So that is something that we should always take into account here. So to arbitrarily instrument a system, to arbitrarily look at what's going on inside of that system, we sort of need a programming language. We need to describe, hey, when that happens, please emit data so I know what's going on. So who did what to whom and when is kind of like a catchphrase here. So D-Trace comes with such a programming language, which is called D. It's not the D from Digital Mars, but it's a different D. And this language is kind of reminiscent of Awk, with a little bit of C in there, and you will see what I mean by that. So it's pretty simple to learn. You can pick it up in like 10 to 20 minutes and start churning out your first D-Trace scripts, which I think is my favorite thing about D-Trace. It's simple to learn, and you get a lot of information out of your out of the system. And I said it's reminiscent of Awk. And to me, D and D-Trace is like Awk for system behavior. So that's a little bit mind-boggling, but you will probably see what I mean by that. So to give you a little demo of what's actually what you can do with D-Trace, I want to show you something that was kind of recent. So this year started with some bad news for all of us. So here I'm at a functional programming conference where people are saying, okay, we use this nice stuff, nice programming languages to make secure software, but now we figured out, well, hardware. CPUs are kind of like not playing nice with us. And so I want to give a little demo. So I asked, are there three people who want to give me a little hand here? So three people, just one person, come on, you're there. Okay, and the third round, the D-Trace user. That's great. So I want to show you a little Spectre attack. And I'm going to use D-Trace to get some timing information. So you, three people, you are sort of like catch lines. And so there is a secret information that I want to extract by using you. And so it's a number from 1 to 3, and I'm just going to pick one. I'm just going to pick 2. So just pretend that I don't know 2. So you are in the L2 cache, and this area right over here is the L1 cache. So I am now going to take you and pull you into the L1 cache. So now, when I want to figure out which memory I've touched, so reaching up to you takes a lot of time. Going to you doesn't take a lot of time. Going to you, well, that takes a lot of time. So I can extract from this information. I'm not necessarily interested in you, no offense. I'm interested in your position. Your position is 2, and that is the secret information that I wanted to extract. I use you as a covert now. Thank you. You might give them a hand. So now I'm going to show you a little bit of code. And sadly, this is going to be C code. Hopefully, this was kind of understandable. So, interpretive dance here. I'm not going to go through all this code. But what I'm going to do is, so we have this little array that we had over there, this array of people. This is the probe array, which we did define this here. And don't mind all of these constants. I'm just trying to put the memory, put all the information like wide enough from each other so we don't have cache effects interfering with each other. So this is just playing a little bit of stuff here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a little array, and then I'm going to put some secret information behind that array. So this program is correct, and I shouldn't be able to read that. So here we have this little check. So here is a little check. I is smaller than attempt size. This is the size of the array. So we shouldn't be able to read past that array. We shouldn't be able to read past the attempts array. So behind that array, in my setup phase, I put this little secret, which is the value 41, which is uppercase A in ASCII. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go over this loop a couple of times, and then I'm going to check if this condition is true. So I'm going to check, okay, is this index that we're going to look into the arrays for that thing, is that small enough? Or are we doing an out-of-bounds check? So with this attempt array, the last one that I'm going to use there is going to go out of bounds. But I'm going to do a little trick here. I'm going to fool the processor a little bit. So to keep our processors working, there's a lot of stuff going on to keep the pipelines full. And there's one thing that's called speculative execution. And what happens is when this thing, this check, takes a bit longer, the processor will look at the history of that jump, and we'll figure out, we'll look at the history of if this thing evaluated true or false, or where did it jump. So in case this is not, so it's going to execute this speculatively if it decides, well, the jump is true. So we went through that thing like a couple of times, and we trained that thing, and what I'm going to do is, yes, I'm going to move that thing, that variable, out of the cache. So this will now take longer. And after we've trained that thing, it will execute this speculatively. So it will also do that for when, so now this, the last check, this thing is wrong, but it takes some time for the processor to figure that out. It's not true anymore, it would normally jump here, but we want to keep the cache lines full, and therefore it's going to execute this one speculatively. And later on, I'm going to go here, and you see I'm not doing anything magical over here. I'm just going to read from that array. And I'm going to use dtrace to measure just that little read. That's the only thing I'm just going to read the time in nanoseconds that this is going to take. And from that, I will conclude the secret value of 41. So I know that's kind of like, it's very subtle. It's not like, oh yeah, sure, I know what's going on there. But so a lot of these, so let's look at the script first. I'm going to use this time stream. So this, you can see that's pretty simple. So I'm going to take you through the motions of what that program actually does. So I'm going to look at the probe function. That is the one where I read out. And you can see these numbers at the end. These are the instruction offsets. I'm going to go through what that means. So please don't be afraid. This is just an example to show you what dtrace can do, and I will explain all of these things later on. So then I'm going to measure the time in nanoseconds, and then I'm just going to print out all of the reads that I had and how long they took. So let's run that. So we're going to take dtrace, we're going to take a script, we're going to take a timing script, and we're going to execute the specter. And I'm going to do that quietly. So these are the timestamps for all the reads that I just did. And this doesn't work all the time. There's some sort of, so yeah, we'll look at that. I don't know if you can read that, so I will make it a little bit larger. So here you can see that's just a slightly. So we're measuring it really precise here. So this is, to me, that is really one of the nice features of dtrace. You can measure with extreme precision here. We're measuring here in nanoseconds. And just because this takes a little bit less, I can conclude from that that the secret value is 41. So this is just a little bit of hopefully inspirational content to show you, wow, you can do a lot of this stuff. So even if you didn't understand that, that wasn't really the point. The point was to give you sort of like slight intuition about what this attack is about. And wow, you can use dtrace, a tool that is built into this operating system. So this is FreeBSD. That you can use that with onboard tools to extract information. So I think this is a pretty fun example. So let's get here into the demos. So let's get into So there are a couple of interesting things there. I want to take this apart now, and so we understand what's basically going on there. So there are a couple of interesting things here, like two things that I find interesting. So this one is what we call a probe. So a probe defines a part of the system, part of the program that we can instrument. We can, whenever something happens, an event happens, the probe is going to fire, and we can see that something happened. So this is how we identify a probe. It's this four tuple. So we have four bits of information that uniquely identify such a probe. So the first one is called the provider, and I will go into what providers mean in a couple of minutes, or seconds. And the second one is called the module, the third one is called the function, and the last one is called the name. So I will show you a couple of those. The second thing that is interesting is this is the body. The body that is going to be, the clause. We're going to execute that piece of code whenever this event occurs. So this is what's happening here. So when we execute this instruction there, we're going to start measuring time, and when we get to the next instruction, we will print out the timing result. So if you look at the disassembly of this thing, you will see that we just basically just time one MUF instruction. So I mentioned something about providers here. So I want to show you what providers are. So the first part of this four tuple is called a provider. And so there are a couple of these things. And these are all the providers that I can see right now on my system. And a provider is something that knows how to inspect a specific part of the operating system, a specific part of your system. We're going to look at two of these providers so you can get a feeling of how D-Trace works. So I've got 27 providers on this system. There are some that you do not see, so you'll probably wonder, I used this PID provider there. There are some providers that do not show up here, and we'll get to that a little bit later. So first of all, I want to look at syscall and FPT. So every provider knows how to instrument a specific part of the system. So what does the system syscall provider know how to inspect? Well, syscalls. That's not really surprising. So let me look at all of the syscalls. This is a listing of every provider, every probe that is visible by the syscall provider. And here you can see all of the syscalls that D-Trace gives me. So here you can see this four tuple. So provider, module, the function, and the name. So now we can look at whenever you enter a syscall and when you return from a syscall. So you can do stuff like that. And now we can see every syscall that's happening on the system right now, live. Which is pretty neat, but you might probably guess what's happening here. It's doing a lot of writes. What's going on there? Yeah, we kind of watch ourselves right into the terminal. So that's not particularly useful, but I think it's kind of funny. Now you can see that. And we could also look at, this is a little bit of improvising here. Now we can use your exec name. And now you can see, it was pretty much D-Trace. It was D-Trace the whole time. And I want to get a little bit more exec name. It's not D-Trace. Oops. And now I can just look at all the other things that's going on. Go see my terminal, watch Xorg on my, and I'm not really slowing down the system, which I think is pretty amazing on a production system. So yeah, that was just a short demo. So there is another provider that's one of my favorite providers, which is called the FBT provider. And the FBT stands for Function Boundary Tracer. So what the Function Boundary Tracer does, it knows how to instrument every single function inside of the kernel. So now we could look as all these function calls happen. So I've wrote a very simple D-trace script here. And this is like probably the first stuff that you will come up with when you start writing D-trace scripts. And I will walk you through this. So here we have this probe specified, the mmap entry. So whenever we are entering the mmap system call, we are going to set this variable follow to 1. And what this means is we're going to associate that value follow with the currently running thread. So we're going to inspect that one thread. So the second thing is, now that sounds super scary, so I'm going to instrument every single function call inside of the kernel. I'm going to see when all of these functions are going to be called. And here, this is called a predicate. So this is where the awk style of D comes in. Whenever we are in the thread that we're currently following, we're just going to say, okay, we were here. We came through that. And when we return from that syscall, and we are in the thread that we're currently following, we're just going to deallocate that thing and we're just going to exit. So let me execute that. And let me show you what that means. So this is every kernel function that happens inside of the kernel when I'm doing this mmap call. So you can see this is a little bit hard on the eyes. I can pass the dash capital F here. And now I can look at all of these things. I can look at what's happening inside of the kernel. Which can be kind of useful when you're trying to figure out, okay, there's something very odd going on in my system. And then things like that can be kind of helpful. But later on, I will show you that we can also do that for processes. I kind of like did that with the D-trace script for Spectre. So we can do that as well. Let me show you. Let me just pause for a second because this might be a little bit scary, because what we did now is we injected code into the kernel and then we're going to execute that. So we can't do like, okay, we can write a little script and push that into the kernel and like this is probably not going to end well because What happens if you there's a script that might go rogue on your kernel and just like allocate a lot of memory and just like, or just spin forever? And that's neat about this D language. It basically doesn't allow things like writing endless loops and stuff like that. And so it's designed to write programs that run in the kernel. And what I also find kind of interesting is this. So you can see this is a little bit my. This is a conference that was basically meant for a hacker conference, so I apologize in advance. So this is a bytecode that. So the D-trace script. This is the D-trace script I just used, and this gets compiled to a bytecode, and this gets sent to the kernel, and this gets executed inside of the kernel, inside of a virtual machine, which is pretty helpful because now we have this virtual machine that can control the behavior of that script. So you cannot just allocate memory like infinitely and just like blow up the kernel or just loop infinitely. This can be controlled by the virtual machine. It's not an entirely new idea. You can see the same things with TCP dump and stuff like that. So I find this kind of like reassuring, like, okay, I can inject stuff into my kernel and things will not randomly explode on me, especially in production. You don't want to inject stuff into your kernel and then have various sysadmins yelling at you for doing so, which might probably happen. So right now I just showed you like kernel stuff, functions getting called. What about arguments? What about looking at things that are inside of our arguments? I should have prepared that better. I apologize. So I want to look at this function, the vmfold function. And this basically gets executed when page fault happens. So What is a page fault? Is we're just basically are pulling information into main memory. Very simplified explanation of that. And I want to be able to look at all of these different arguments. So we have the zeroth argument, first, second, and third argument. So let's look at that. So this is like a super big struct inside of the system. So this is like a whole amount of information that is inside of that argument. And I want to be able to see that. I want to be able to look at all these information. So I have a little script here. I should probably open that in here. So this is a little dtrace script that I wrote to inspect this vmfold function. So whenever we enter it, and the process is not like dtrace itself, so we don't want to trace ourselves because, as we found out, that's kind of boring. So I want to look at some information here. And you probably saw me using this exec name variable, which basically this is like the current executable that we're executing. We have a PID. And here we're looking at the different arguments that we have passed to the vmfold function. So arg1, arg2, arg3, and these are essentially just integers. So yes, I'm using that to translate this integer to some more readable information there, because these are just flags inside of the kernel. But another thing that I want to do is remember that zeroth argument. That was this big struct, and I'm going to look at that. So what I'm going to use here is I'm going to use this args array, and this args array gives me access to typing information inside, which is stored inside of a special session. And this print function can use this typing information. So let's just execute that thing, and let's just look at what this does, because that's one of my favorite things. Looking at that, and let me just run something. So this is a live kernel data structure. So I can look at live memory inside of the kernel. I can, I could manipulate that thing just like a C structure. So I can, now everything is transparent inside of my system. I don't like cars, but I like car analogies. Imagine you are on the Autobahn and driving like really fast, and suddenly you hear a weird noise. You slow down a little bit, that noise goes away. So what's going on? So okay, you speed up again, noise reappears. So you cannot just get out of the car and look at what's going wrong there. That would be kind of deadly. But imagine like with a dtrace analog, you could. Like you were like traveling at 200 miles per hours, you just leave your car while doing so. You open you want to look at the motor, you take the motor out, you take the motor apart, you are still moving. Your car didn't slow down while you were doing that. And suddenly you figure out, oh, there's a little animal inside of my motor block for some reason. And now you figure out the problem without stopping your engine, which is essential if you are running on a system where you can't just turn it off, because then you get really angry customers. And you cannot slow it down, because then you will also get really angry customers. And also these kind of like Heisenbugs that never really show up when you look for them. Like, okay, now try to reproduce that on a development box. No, that's not going to happen, because bugs only happen in production, because that's the way it goes. So now I can really look at every little aspect inside of my program. I find this absolutely mind-boggling, to be honest. I could use that to debug very, very nasty bugs in drivers back then in Solaris. That was like extremely useful to me. And you could also do that you could also do that for more complicated things. And usual space stuff. So I want to show you something that I worked on for about a week. I have this like very, very boring program here, and let me just start a new tab because I don't have enough tabs right now. So this is like a super boring Haskell program. And what it does, Haskell, wow, I mean, now finally we're talking about something that's functional. So sorry about that. But so this thing just basically starts 32 green threads and schedules them all over the place. So I assume most of you are working with a high-level programming language, like Haskell or Erlang or Python maybe, or Node.js for whatever reason. You want to look inside of that thing. And what I showed you is like, okay, I did show you how C functions get called, which is not very useful when you want to look at the runtime system of a programming language. You're executing that weird function inside of the runtime system. That doesn't help me a lot. So there are ways to equip your runtime system with static probes that emit data whenever you have a certain event occurring. So it gives us a little bit more semantics here. So when we are, let's just do it that way. So this is live information from the Haskell runtime system. So I can see, okay, these there's thread and stop, and maybe we can see some garbage collection over there. Here's thread suspended. Well, this just repeats. Oh, 7-ish until all done. Now we can build dtrace scripts that take all of these things into account that I just showed you. You can build dtrace scripts that can also take events in your Haskell program into account, which I find insanely useful. I didn't manage to come up with like super cool examples here because this is like super new. This works on macOS, but I just made that work on FreeBSD. So I had to fight with linkers to do that, so it felt like very dirty. But anyway, so now you can do that. There are more of these static providers there. So you don't want to know how your TCP/IP stack or how your scheduler, how all these different functions inside of kernel, what is responsible for, let's say, handling TCP/IP. So there is this TCP provider where you can say, hey, this connection has been established, and here is connection being closed, and now you can write things that take all of these things into account. You can do things like I/O scheduling. So you can measure time it takes to do certain I/O operations. There's a very interesting video on YouTube that it's Don't Yell in the Data Center, where you can see like a big server, and then an operator just goes there and he says, don't try that at home, and he yells into the hard drives. And what they're doing is they're tracing I/O performance with that thing. And as he yells, you can see the I/O performance. It just plummets, and like you can basically see the vibration of yelling at that thing, which was absolutely impossible before that. And like, wow, this is insane. How can you do that? And you can write lots of very ridiculous scripts, stuff like that. It's the amount of information you can squeeze out of your system. It's just mind-blowing. You can build these things, you can build them yourselves, these and bake them into your program. And you've built your own probes with certain semantics. So I would probably, I probably cannot show you speculation, but I will like outline what it does. So there is another feature that sadly doesn't get demoed that much, but I will probably won't make the demo right now. You can also, like, sometimes you want to collect data and then decide decide when something happens, you want to see that data. Like, I want to see what happens inside of the kernel when your when the open syscall exits with a fault. So the problem is you already traced all this information and you like just blew it out of the terminal, and you can't just take that back. You cannot roll that back. But there is this, you can see I initialized the speculation there. I can speculate on this thing, and whenever I do speculate, this information is written into a specific buffer. And so here is when I'm a small person. So whenever the open at syscall returns with an error, I'm going to commit that buffer. And otherwise, I'm just going to discard it. So I can also do that. I can do filtering of events that already happened when based on events that happen later on, which is also very useful, because when you have a lot of this information just flowing in and you just want to see that one event and you want to filter after the fact. So yeah, probably not demo that, but so just, you know, there's a lot of tooling around this. This is just like the tip of the iceberg. You can also like look at if you one short thing here. This syscall entry. So whenever we do that, and I want to look at the use stack of the program. So not S. Got too many S's. And these are just a lot of stuff here. Now can you user space backtrack here? So hey, I've entered a syscall, I've entered the UMTX entry, and this is how I got there. And a lot of information you can get out of the system. So that's basically everything I wanted to show you, just to make you interested in using a tool like that, because to me it basically changed the way I think about software. And it's not an exaggeration. When you suddenly in the position to look at what's going on inside of the system, that just changes everything at how you look at things, and how you choose software. And just a little warning, you will get angry. You will see things that you cannot unsee anymore, sadly. But that is basically it. There's a very thick book, like this thick book on dtrace. I encourage you to buy that, and it's mind-blowing, and you will think about operating systems and software a whole lot differently. So thanks for your attention, and maybe we have some time for questions. So.
Enough time for questions.
Yes. Questions.
You mentioned there are other tools for the Linux people. What would those be?
That tool is called eBPF. I have to admit that I haven't played with that. It's an extension of the Berkeley packet filter. And I tried to play with it, but I was basically led to a whole bag of blog posts, and here, figure it out. So that's what I personally like about dtrace. It's very easy to get started with it, and I didn't find that same thing for eBPF. So there's also a port for dtrace, which is called dtrace for Linux. But since due to licensing issues, because UPL is basically incompatible with everything, you cannot just like ship that with me, things. But you can patch your kernel and have something like that. It's very tightly built into the kernel. Yeah. So. Okay.
Yeah, my actual question, you just answered the eBPF one, but I did actually read that Oracle is now considering a proper port dtrace to Linux, which is fantastic.
Exactly. Oracle thing. I think Oracle wants to release some of the dtrace stuff under GPL, which would allow that. But I don't know. I think it's a little bit too late and too little, because Open dtrace has been there for a long time now. Since it's basically since Oracle closed Open Solaris, there have been a couple of years, and Open dtrace didn't stand still. They did a lot of stuff. This print stuff that I showed you, that is something that is an open dtrace. And not, as far as I know, I didn't bother looking at Oracle Dtrace, to be quite honest, because that's, it's there, I have it, it's an open tool, and I can use it, I can develop on that. So yeah, we will see how that turns out. I think the Dtrace folks are not that super interested, because it has been developed in any way, but I don't think Linux people are too keen on that as well, because they now have eBPF. I don't know. I'm not using Linux, so
I... Like, it's so cool, like, the interface is, like, ridiculous, amazing, yeah?
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe something will change. We'll see. Any more questions? Okay.
Can you trace something conditionally, like, looking at the disk I/O that happens during...
Thank you for that question. Of course, you can do that conditionally. I didn't really highlight these things here. That is a predicate. So whenever that predicate evaluates to true, this body of functions is going to fire. Thank you so much for that question, because I forgot it. I forgot to mention that. It's a little hard to, when you explain programming languages, you suddenly forget stuff. But yeah, you can do that conditionally. Oh, there.
What was the problem you got into touch with Dtrace in the first place? So was there a specific problem you were trying to solve, or
The problem is that I'm a nerd. So I first saw that presentation by Brian Cantrell, which is called Dtrace Review, and I can highly recommend that. It's where he basically demonstrates some of the stuff that I just showed you, just a little bit more depth and with more metaphors. But that to me was like mind-blowing. I was like, I wanted to have a tool like that forever. I didn't think it was possible, but apparently it is. So, and now I'm like debugging the user space stuff, kernel space stuff. It helps me a lot to read kernel code. Like, this is interesting for me. I want to figure out what's going on there. Why is my operating system behaving weirdly under memory pressure or whatever? And then you figure out, that process just killing all my whatever, like all my performance. But yeah. Do we still have time?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
As far as I understand, Dtrace generates these events, and then you have the D script, which kind of filters it out and shows you only the things that kind of run through the predicates and so on and so forth. What happens with the data? Is it gone? Can I store it somewhere?
So the way that it actually works, so the question is, how does this work? How so we send that program to the kernel in the virtual machine. So we take that D script, we compile it, we send it to the kernel, and then depending on the architecture, you're using different mechanisms here. On x86, you're using interrupt 3, to trigger the debug interrupt. And what happens then, it's going to write into something that we call principal buffer. And this buffer gets filled, and then you have a consumer like the Ctrace command line tool, and this is going to read out that buffer. So you have like two buffers there, one is going to fill, and you read from the other one, and then you're going to switch these buffers, and then you're going to read and switch, and you have different policies that you can use for switching for how these buffers work. Can you use a ring buffer when you have like one trace like for ages, because something just happens like a week in, you can use that. There are current different buff policies that are called. I don't know if you can write that to a file. Yes, you can. And of course, you can pipe the output to a file. Yes, you can do that. You can also look at memory and look at the bytes that are currently there. So maybe that helps. I don't know. If that solves your problem.
Great. Thank you again.
Thank you very much.